When the truth is found to be lies, and all the joy within you dies. Don't you want somebody to love? Don't you need somebody to love? Don't you love somebody to love? You better find somebody to love.
You are listening to 102.7 CFRO Vancouver Cooperative Radio. The name of this show is Path to Love, and it's a radio program dedicated, basically it's a show dedicated to recognizing all the types of love that exist and the right to that love. There's all types of love. There's love for, you know, your fellow human being, love for nature, love for a better life, and then there's love between people. And so we want to recognize the different types of love and also raise awareness about how it is being suppressed and how important it is, how essential love is in our daily lives, yet in various forms it's we're prevented from experiencing love. And we will tour around the world, but we're going to also focus on a particular country, Iran. So this program is actually in two pieces. It's first half hour from 2 to 2:30 is in English, and then from 2:30 to 3 is in Farsi. And this is really our kickoff, and we're going to listen to a song, and I'll give you more detail about the program and the campaign that we've launched along with this radio show.
What a difference a day made. 24 little hours. What the sun and the flowers. Yesterday was blue day. Today I'm a part of you, dear. My lonely nights are through, dear. Since you said you were mine. A day makes. There's a rainbow before me. Skies above can't be stormy. Since that moment of bliss, your menu. What a difference a day made. And the difference is you.
That was Dina Washington, What a Difference a Day Makes. And before that, you heard the song by Jefferson Airplane, Somebody to Love. So I'll tell you more about this campaign, and then we'll go back to music. This show is going to be just, you know, a short show to simply explain what the campaign is about. And in the next next program, we're going to have a special guest to give us their opinion about the whole topic. Right off the bat, I mean, just myself being one of the organizers of this, I realized how wide the issue of love really is. I mean, we take it for granted. We use the word quite a lot. But it really comes down to a great deal of a great deal of our daily issues, basically. A great deal of our lives comprise of our seeking love and experiencing love. And it relates to so many wide different issues. It relates to LGBT rights. It relates to women's rights and in many places, discrimination against women, very harsh sentencing such as stoning. It relates to our interest in helping each other, huge issue, helping, having the compassion, basically. That is one type of love. So what we're doing now is we're conducting this campaign till Valentine's Day. We might continue after that, but on February 12th, Saturday, 2 days before Valentine's Day, we're having an event. Basically we're leading up to that right now through our radio shows. And just so because we wanted to have a, you know, an event dedicated to love and to the right to love. And we realized how wide the issue is. And that's why we suggested that we do a radio program each week that researches the different issues and engages in also in an internet campaign to raise awareness. So we'll research the issues. We'll try to define love better, along with guests and work that's already been done, as well as our own debates and discussions. And we'll explore how central it is. We'll explore the right of having love and how we can achieve that right. and we will fight. We will fight against all the different types of restrictions to the right to love. And during all that, basically, we will debate the root of the problem. And we had a small introduction to this issue. What is the root of the problem? How can the problem be solved? And I will play something that we discussed within our committee that's organizing this event about whether politics is more central in restricting our right, or is it cultural issues? And the reason this came up is because often I've encountered situations where I want to, where I'm talking to someone and the other person tells me, well, we have such a big cultural problem. Really, politics is not the problem. We should fix our culture first. And this just is a little misleading to me, but Alborz was able to clarify that for me and we were able to explore this issue. So I will put on a song, and then I'll come back with basically a little discussion me and Alborz had. Alborz being another committee member that is in Toronto. He's a LGBT rights activist as well as a language rights activist for the Turkmen people in Iran, and basically the rights of people that are not of exactly Persian, Iranian, or Muslim, Shiite descent to have their rights in Iran. And he's very active in the Toronto community. He has a article, and we'll get to our committee issue as well. I'll give a little introduction to our committee at the end, towards the end of the program. So we'll listen to his song, and we'll be right back to discuss it all. So we're back at 102.7 CFRO Co-op Radio. We do have a telephone you can call, and if you'd like, we'll bring you on the air, or you can just give your opinion. Our number is 604-684-7561, and you can also access the show via the internet, just www.cooperadio.org, and you'll see the link to listen live. The song that we just listened to was Elvis Costello, What Is Funny About Peace, Love, and Understanding. So as I mentioned earlier, we were debating the issue within our committee in terms of what approach we should take, what we should target as a way to change, to bring about change ultimately. And the debate is whether politics or culture are which one is more central, which one should be the target of our campaign. And this has developed in the last week quite fast through or just discussing this with various people. A lot of people, you know, mentioned a valid point that the economic issues are very central, and economic approaches should be taken. In any case, I'll leave you with a little discussion between me and Alborz about this, and then we'll be back again.
We need to have a cultural change before we can have a political change. And what I mean by this is that a lot of times we do lie to each other and we do have, you know, misogyny and homophobia. I'm not saying that we should wait until we have, you know, this ideal society where women are totally equal with men, where homophobia is eliminated, and, you know, we don't lie to each other and we're against corruption and everything. We don't even have this in Canada yet. So to say that we should have this in Iran completely is kind of, you know, almost a dream. At the same time, I don't agree with the reformist staff, where basically they have this defeated attitude, where they're basically saying, okay, you know what, Iranian society is, you know, backwards. We can never have, you know, full democracy. We can only have it, like you said, within 100 years. We have to wait until Iranians move on from this. And in the meantime, we should just accept reforms, but, you know, a few things are reformed here and there. But within the past 30 years, we've seen a reform really hasn't done much for Iran at all, really. I mean, what's the difference? Okay, instead of women wearing chador, they have to wear a hijab now. You see, there's not a huge difference, really, between reform, you know, liberal reform and a conservative government that we have now. What we need is we need real change, and we know that Iranians actually support real change. We have these things in Iran where we have, you know, stoning and flogging and honor killings and stuff. Would I say that most Iranians agree with this? Absolutely not. Personally, from my own experience with Iranians, I don't think that we do support misogyny and, I'm sorry, not misogyny. We don't support flogging and, you know, stoning to death adulterers and stuff like that. We don't support that. But at the same time, we turn so apathetic that we're not really willing to do anything about it.
I think I totally get what you're saying. If we were going to draw a diagram, it seems to me that you're saying that if we were going to draw a flow chart, it would first step, first part, first little box would be, you know, a cultural issue such as apathy, and then that and then you would want to change that, and then there would be a arrow to politics. If you change that, then the politics changes, and then the next box would be wider cultural change. There'd be an arrow to culture again. So it would go from cultural change to political change, and then that political change would then in turn come back and change culture more widely. Is this an accurate description of what you're telling me?
Yeah,
basically?
Generally, basically, what I'm saying is what you just said right now. The more general message that I was trying to get is that we've adopted things like, you know, they're superficial things that we've adopted from the Islamic regime, like, you know, homophobia and misogyny and things like that. I'm not saying these are superficial in the sense that they're fake, but rather they're tangible things. They're tangible policies and they're tangible social remnants that we have that are from the Islamic regime. And then we have white attitudes that we've adopted as a result of being hit by the Islamic regime, hit by the Pahlavis, hit by the Qajar era, hit by basically wanting a democracy that we've had for the past century that we've never been able to achieve, and yet we're still trying to achieve now. And those things are mostly things like lying and corruption and honesty and, you know, overall a sense of being able to have dialogue and communicate with others and being able to comprehend other people's ideas. If we have those things, then we can have things like, then we can have policies against misogyny, against homophobia, against the death penalty, things like that. If we don't have a base that's honest, if we don't have a base that's anti-corruption, if we don't have a base that's pro-democracy and listening to other views rather than, you know, simply laughing and smirking with other people saying, yeah, this is my opinion, this is my opinion, and yet none of your opinions actually change after that discussion, then we can't have those things that we want, like human rights for women, for LGBT, for the working class, for things like that. We can't have those things.
I understand. I see exactly what you're saying. You're saying it is rooted in the political events, all these, you know, cultural problems that we have, or apathetic problems, and so and you know, dishonesty. You know, there's many different things. There's deceptive tactics within the opposition, and basically, if our political movement starts on the right with a good culture, then we can basically bring about cultural change through politics. If our political movement has good principles,
exactly.
Yeah, I see exactly what you're saying. I think it's a very a good starting point for us, and it's a practical starting point for us as you know, political opposition activists. And you know, a lot of people are saying the same thing, and I see some people trying to say, look, what we have to learn is to tolerate different points of view, and what we have to learn is to be honest and transparent, and then that way, we may be able to, you know, attract more people, and then in that way we might, if we start off on the right foot, then maybe the end result will be correct as well. If we start off with contradictions, and if we start off with corruptive practices, then it's not going to go anywhere. And even if it does, it's not going to create the cultural changes that we want. So, is there anything else you'd like to add?
Well, just basically my last point is I agree with everything you just said. I agree with your stuff.
Okay, so you heard the little discussion, and this will be an ongoing theme. This is what we're doing in both languages. As I mentioned earlier, we're going to do some research. We're going to try to define love, try to explore the definition of it, and then explore the conditions, research the conditions that exist all over the world against it, and then discuss how we can bring about change, what types of approaches we can take. Just a little background on our committee. We're, as you can tell, we're an international committee, but we do have local committees as well. I won't be able to get too far into it right now. We'll try to set aside a special time to discuss the committee completely, what we've done so far, and what we've learned from working together towards various causes. We have had a few events. We had recently October 2nd, we had an event right here in Vancouver where people from a variety of cultural backgrounds came together and discussed how what their experiences of oppression were. We had Armenian activists participating, Syrian activists participating, Kurdish and Iranian, and still a lot of activists we were in touch with, but we couldn't just for that event coordinate it in time. But it was just a stepping stone for us to discuss a shared pains that we have across cultures. And it was also commemoration for all the people that have suffered and basically lost their lives, and it was to take it forward and debate the various methods we can take. And our committee, the principle behind it is that we don't decide on ideology or methodology to bring about change, but we see ourselves as a neutral party that seeks to coordinate the dialogue, seeks to bring as many people with all types of backgrounds into it, And so anyone can participate with us. And that way, we're hoping that basically inclusivity. And if you look up Alborz Atash Band, who was just speaking, he has a little article about inclusivity and the issue that we don't want to put a stamp on our program or a logo on ourselves. We ideologically, methodologically, or as an organization, we want to be completely neutral. And that is so far, it's worked for us so far. And we've thrown a few other events, a protest and another event in Toronto, which was an International NEDA Day. But we discussed all the lives that have been lost in Iran. It's an internet campaign. We have a member in Iran. We have a number of collaborators, and we work on a consensus basis. We also work with another group called The Call. And The Call is actually an association of a variety of media groups. So we've been working on this for 2 years, and we have our own network. We have our own voice and our own influence. And the idea of The Call is to bring together all the different media groups that have been working so hard towards the same goal, and come out of being isolated from each other and work together as well as work on our own programs. And this way, being an alternative to what is being provided to Iranians right now, which is either state-run TV, state-run programming mostly, or a lot of the even satellite and non-state-run are still affiliated or associated and run by some kind of government. There's, for example, the Voice of America, there's BBC as well that are highly used in Iran. And it's not an issue that, you know, we want to, this organization wants to, you know, just because they're associated with the government, come in and be an alternative. It's not just that, it's that it really seriously hurts us, because there's many issues that are not explored, can't be explored. And so we're trying to organize something along those lines. So we'll probably talk about all this at a later time. We're going to play a song and switch over to the Farsi segment of our program.